Now, Li Jingling is a very popular guest on the mother of all talk shows. She is a journalist, a political commentator, broadcaster extraordinaire. Please welcome Li Jingjing back to the mother of all talk shows. After too long an absence, I must say, it's wonderful to see you again, especially given the time in China. Let me throw out how it seems to me. I might be wrong. I hope I'm right. That actually the G20 marked something of a breakthrough for China, not just with its friends reconfirming its friendships, but also a slight softening of the aggressive attitude of the Biden administration. Is that how you saw it, or am I just looking for moonbeams?
Okay, thanks, George. Always so happy to be back on your show. It's indeed quite a long time, but I think this conversation, this invitation came at a good, perfect timing, because a lot of things happened in China and about China. As you mentioned, just during the G20, it is a big deal for China, because at the G20 and also the APEC meeting in Southeast Asia, several world leaders, head of states, that met Chinese President Xi Jinping. And you mentioned the most important, not most important, but actually the one that get the world's attention, is the in-person meeting between Chinese President Xi Jinping and the U.S. President Joe Biden. Not only that's the first in-person meeting since Joe Biden took office, it's also the first meeting between the two after the relationship between the two countries keep getting worse and worse, going downhill, like free fall, basically, and especially after Nancy Pelosi's visit to Taiwan. So this meeting helped to, I think it helped to the both countries to find a solution to manage the conflicts. And actually, if you look at the diplomatic words from both sides, both sides use the word candid conversation. Both sides describe this meeting as candid conversation, that both countries discuss all these conflicts that are facing these two countries and how to manage it. And both sides stress they don't want this competition to veer into a huge conflict. And I think I can get some quotes from the both sides. On China's side, it's pretty clear, says, China-U.S. relations should not be a zero-sum game where one side outcompete or thrives at the expense of the others. And President Xi Jinping said it very clear that the country, the world is pretty big enough for both countries to develop. And the U.S. side, if you read the readouts from the White House, actually the readouts from China and the U.S. are not actually the same, but some words are similar. And the U.S. side, they also stress that they don't want to turn this competition between China and U.S. to turn into a conflict. And they want to manage the competition responsibly and maintain open lines of communication. So it looks like this meeting is helping this relation to not keep going downward further. But of course, we are not naive that especially in the complex of global geopolitical conflicts in terms of global politics, we're not naive that one meeting will forever change everything. But at least we are seeing an intention, a trend that both sides want to manage it. But I think whether this thing can be changed really depends on whether the U.S. side can adhere to what they said. And one thing I'm a little bit worried is because in the U.S. readout, they once again talk about how concerned they are about China's domestic affairs. They keep mentioning like Hong Kong or Xinjiang, Uyghur Autonomous Region, and Tibet, how much they're concerned about human rights in China. First, the many things that happened in those regions are actually created and filled by the U.S.-funded separatist groups and NEDs. So they create a certain problems and then use those problems to claim, oh, you have human rights concerns, you have human rights issues. And second, like, just imagine in a diplomatic meeting, you talk about other, another country's domestic affairs. Just imagine, what if China in this readout talk about how much we concerned about the racism in the United States, how much we concerned about the rising population in prison in the United States, how much we concerned about the gun violence in the United States. Just imagine what US would react if China said that, but China didn't. In the work report, like, China never mentioned anything about the US domestic affairs, even though they have a lot of problems, because each country should deal with their problems by themselves. So that's what I'm concerned. And we're going to keep a close eye on whether the US will abide by their words. And I think I need to stress one more thing, because what will affect the two countries' relations is the US stance on Taiwan. During this readout, during this meeting, the US once again said they will adhere to the one China policy. They are not intended to change China's political system. They're not intended to create two Chinas or one China, one Taiwan. So they promised once again, they adhere to the one China policy. But we also know, even though they've been saying this all the time, but in reality, you see people like Nancy Pelosi, a lot of senators flying to the Taiwan island, and they also sell arms, weapons to the Taiwan island, even though not really useful arms anyway, but still. So in reality, they are doing this. But China, I think what is really stand out is China really make clear Taiwan is at the core of China's core interests. And this is being said by Xi during the President Xi and Joe Biden's meeting, and also once again being reiterated at yesterday's the defense minister's meeting. China's defense minister and U.S. foreign the defense minister met. They once again said it. So, and Taiwan question is so important to all China. And once again, China said, made it clear, it's the core of China's core interest. It's the first right line of China's all right lines and cannot be crossed. And once the US cross that right line, this thing probably cannot be reversed.
Well, that's I think, an entirely accurate summation. And you can confirm that by how the other issues, like Tibet, like the Muslim question in Xinjiang and so on, these have dropped down the agenda. Even Hong Kong has dropped down the propaganda agenda in the West in favor of Taiwan. It's quite clear that Taiwan is what they see as their number one opportunity to cause problems for you. But before I ask you to respond to that, isn't the problem this, that it's all very well to say, let's have a competition rather than a conflict. Mm-hmm. Because if one side is winning the competition, winning out the park, to use a sporting metaphor, as successful as its competitors are failures, whose economy continues to burgeon and grow while the other shrinks and atrophies. And in the case of the European economy, is about to go into the deepest of deep freezes. The other side, while saying it's happy to have a competition, doesn't want to have a conflict, will increasingly entertain the idea of a conflict, not least to kickstart their economies and spend their way out of the economic desperation that they are in.
Yeah, yeah, I agree with you. And you know, you mentioned the economy in Europe is going downwards. I think that's probably one of the major reasons that Macron from France, German Chancellor Scholz, that met Chinese President Xi Jinping. Schwarz actually came to Beijing to meet President Xi Jinping together with the head of several German firms. So, I mean, that shows how much the Europe's economies probably has been damaged by all these unfair conditions, either by the conflicts in Ukraine or by the United States orders. So every region wants to seek development, economic growth rather than conflicts. Nobody wants to. And I think what said by the Chinese side, something very true and important is the conflicts nowadays between China and the United States is not benefiting both people in China, another people in China and other people in the United States. It's not beneficial to both sides. So it's really important that these countries to find a solution to both to compete, to develop, but not to destroy each other. And also, that's probably also why this meeting between them two got the world's attention, because if any conflicts between such a two major powers will have an impact to the rest of the world. And, you know, I think, I don't know whether people in Europe or in the West have realized there's a big change in the world, not just in China. We're talking about China, blah, blah, blah. And like, I think it's more than China. We should look at Latin America and the Caribbean, Africa, Southeast Asia. And you know what? I really wish people in the West, in Europe, in US, that can come out of their bubble to look at the world, to really look at what people in the rest of the world think. We remember during the Ukraine conflicts, whenever the West talk about the international community, they only refer to global North, basically the G7 countries. They never included people in Asia, in Latin America and the Caribbean, and Africa. They have a different view. For example, some Western countries like United Kingdom, America, they always talk about issues in Hong Kong or the certain regions. But can you think of any Asian countries that make big fuss about the issue in Hong Kong? And not really. Not many Asian countries have the same. Not many Latin American countries or African countries make big fuss about Hong Kong. Why? I think, of course, first, they have a good relationship with China, and they know that's China's domestic issue. And I think another thing that's really important is this country understands what's being a colony. The Hong Kong used to be under colonial rule of the United Kingdom. So these countries, these regions know what it feels like to be under colonial rule. And they understand the complex that led to the situation in places like Hong Kong. So, and they know the Western's role that in this conflict. So you don't hear the voices from these regions. And also, I mean, even if, you know, Western mainstream media and several governments keep vilifying China as this another colonial power, and they keep go to Africa, Latin America, Southeast Asia to warn those regions, don't work with China because China will conquer you. But I think people in those regions, they understand what's colonialism, what's being conquered. There's some jokes because I think it's a joke from a friend from Africa told me, because whenever a U.S. representative go to Africa, they land at an airport built by Chinese, drive a car built on the road built by Chinese, and speak at a venue built by Chinese, and warn the Africans don't work with China. And they go to Latin America, it's the same. A former Chile ambassador to China said, you know what, whenever China's representative came to Latin America, they talk about trade, economic cooperation, but whenever the US representative came to Latin America, they only talk about China. And just past few weeks, we had several major meetings in Southeast Asia, the APEC meeting in Thailand, G20 in Bali, Indonesia, And the ASEAN meeting in Cambodia all took place in Southeast Asia. And I think I see this happen again because I think Joe Biden, when he met Cambodian leader Hun Sen, even though despite talking about corporations, he also secretly asked, hey, do you have China soldiers in your country? And the Cambodian leader Hun Sen said, we don't, but he keep asking. So now this time he came to Southeast Asia. We're going to help you to counter China's influence. But have they ever asked what local people want? They probably not really particularly like China or US or Russia. They just want to have a economic development. They just want to seek what's in the best interest for them. So if the deals offered by China are good, and they will benefit us economically, we will choose that. And we can. So it's. I mean, I think what an audience really need to do is just come out of the bubble, listen to the people
come
outside
out
of
the bubble,
G7.
Is a good summary. Of our discussion. The irony is that without China and Chinese trade, there would be no Thanksgiving tomorrow. At least there would be no toys to give to your children. There would be no Black Friday. There would be nothing in the shops on Black Friday. Ditto on Christmas Day, and so on. Every Latin American country, from Mexico to Chile and Brazil, has China as its major trading partner. Ditto so many European countries. People don't know that. They haven't woken up to that. Lastly, having made the nightmare road journey from Jakarta to Bandung many times, my good wife is Indonesian, I was delighted to see you showcasing the brand new high-speed train from Jakarta to Bandung, which is one of my favorite cities in the world for many reasons. Tell us briefly about that. How did that come about? What did China do?
It took a pretty long time. I forgot the exact amount of time, several years to fully build it. So during the G20, the high-speed rail did a test run, and it will put into operation next year. And it's the first high-speed rail in Indonesia, probably also the first high-speed rail fully used China's technology, China's standard and equipment. So we know infrastructure is really important for economy. We know this from our own country, because my country used to be very underdeveloped, very poor. I went to many provinces in the remote areas. And one thing that used to stop those regions from developing is the steep mountains and lack of roads, the infrastructure to get out. So I think many countries in the developing world also face the same problem. And Western countries said they want to work with, they want to help Southeast Asian countries. They've been in the Southeast Asia for a pretty long time. But did anything like this basic infrastructure happen during their dominance in that region? No. So I think this high-speed rail really going to help to grow, help the Indonesia's economy and also Southeast Asia's economy. But this is not the only the rail that China helped build in Southeast Asia. Just a few months ago, also another rail that connect a city in Laos and China city in Kunming also being put in operation. Just a few months ago, also China's engineers, China's companies helped to build. I think this is all part of a great example what Belt and Road Initiative can help different regions. I know some people, not just from the Western countries, probably from developing world as well, they have concern, is the Belt and Road Initiative really gonna help us? Or will China be another colonial imperial power in the region? But just look at what really being carried out in reality. High-speed rails, first ever being built in Southeast Asia, in Indonesia. in Laos. You know, Laos used to be the landlocked region in Southeast Asia. And in Africa, it's the same. All these infrastructures, ports, roads, airports, these basic infrastructures are making this country stronger. So what kind of imperial power will make their enemies
stronger? What kind of imperialism is that? Well, look, I hope to be on that first journey next year on that train to Bandung. The reality of colonialism in Indonesia can in part be summed up when I tell you that the Dutch colonialists left fewer than 100 graduates in the entire archipelago of Indonesia when they left.